evening. We have done half of the CAT 2017 slot 2 verbal paper in the morning, and now we are continuing with the second half. As we know, there are 34 questions, out of which there are 18 questions in reading comprehension. In the long passages, that's what we have covered in the morning. And right now we are going to cover the two short passages, the three summaries, four parajumbles, and three odd men out, right? That's the entire 16 ka breakup. So great, I'm Munira Lokhandwala and I'm Calcutta alumna, a serial 100 percentiler in CAT and a 99 percentiler in GMAT. I also have a CAT verbal book published by Wiley and
available on Amazon. That's what we've covered in the morning. And right now we are going to cover the two short passages.
Mute this.
The three summaries.
Great. Okay. So you can find me on the Unacademy CrackCAT channel. You can also find me on the app. So guys, just search for the app. I'm sure some of you already have it. If you don't, please install Kijiye. Within that, you have to go for the Plus CAT courses. And besides the Plus CAT courses, you also have some free courses, some special classes, right? And all of them are primed towards helping you crack your CAT, whether it is CAT 20 or 21. We have courses for all CAT aspirants, right? Which subscription to go for, we can talk towards the end of the session. You can use my code MUNIRA10 to get 10% discount, right? Let's start off with a puzzle that I gave you all in the morning. You have two cubes that are stacked. The faces of each cube are labeled with 1, 2, 3, 4 and 6 dots, right? So what is the sum of the dots on a cube? So one cube will have 1 plus 2 plus 3, so on till 6. The sum from 1 to 6, guys, is 21, right? So one cube ka sum is 21. The sum of two cubes will be 42. Right? So we know the total. We know the total of all 12 faces. Two cubes. Eh? One cube has 6 faces. So two cubes will have 12 faces. And out of these 12 faces, 5 are given to us. Right? 4 hai yahan pe 1. This has 5 dots. This is 2 and this is 6. So if we add it up, this is 10 and 18. So out of the 12 faces, 5 faces add up to 18. So the remaining 7 faces must be 42 minus 18, which is 24. Right? So that's your answer, guys, 24. Now let's begin with the verbal section of CAT 2017. This is the slot 2 paper. So I do understand that I am taking up some part of the screen and you may not be able to see the full screen. But if you just click in the description box, guys, you will find the link and you can download the PDF, read it, and then please look at the solutions. Read the passages, solve the answers, and then please look at the solutions, okay? Great. So, I hope you have read this. Typewriters are the epitome of a technology that has been comprehensively rendered obsolete by the digital age. The ink comes off the ribbon, they weigh a ton, and second thoughts are a disaster. Basically, once you have typed something, editing it is a problem. But they are also personal, portable, and above all, private. Type a document and lock it away, and more or less the only way anyone else can get it is if you give it to them. Once you type a document, right, it's not as if it's stored anywhere, it's just on the piece of paper. That is why the Russians have decided to go back to typewriters in some government offices, and why in the US some departments have never abandoned them. Yet, it is not just the resistance to algorithms and secret surveillance that keeps typewriter production lines. Well, one at least, so there's one typewriter still going on in business. The last British one closed a year ago. So there were two some time back. Nor is it only the nostalgic appeal of the metal body and the stout, well-defined keys that make them popular on eBay. So there's some nostalgia as well. A typewriter demands something particular, which is attentiveness. You have to be attentive. By the time the paper is loaded, the ribbon tightened, the carriage returned, the spacing and the margin set, there is a big premium on hitting the right key. That means sorting out ideas, pulling together a kind of order and organizing details before actually striking off. There can be no thinking on screen with a typewriter, nor are there any easy distractions. No online shopping, no urgent emails, no Twitter. So when you're on a typewriter, you're not on the internet, right? No need even for electricity. Perfect for writing in a remote hideaway. The thinking process is accompanied by the encouraging clack of keys and the ratchet of the carriage return, ping. So guys, I hope you all are noticing, right, that when we read, it is essential to be active. We have spoken about this when we were doing the RC concepts also, right? Don't be a passive reader. Be an active reader. So when we are reading here also, right, and we are making all these connections, ki haan, ek business mein abhi hai, ek band ho gaya, etc., etc. All this keeps you in touch with the passage. You get involved, you remember things more easily, right? Okay, so this is more or less about how typewriters are still useful for privacy reasons, right? For the fact that you can be attentive when you're typing, etc. Okay, now let's look at questions. Which one of the following best describes what the passage is trying to do? It describes what is the passage trying to do. It talks about how typewriters are still useful, right? Why people continue to use typewriters. Yeah, this is good. Why typewriters are still useful. It argues that will continue to be used even though they are an obsolete technology. Future ke baare mein, there is nothing given. Okay? And this is quite extreme, that it definitely will be continue to be used. And obsolete technology also is not very clearly mentioned. So B is wrong. It highlights the personal benefits of using typewriters. Well, there are some benefits and it does highlight them. But what is the point? The point is that even now when you think people will not use typewriters, why do people still use typewriters? Yeah, that's why A is better than C. It shows that computers offer fewer options. What computers are offering, not mentioned. So the answer is option A. According to the passage, some governments still use typewriters. Why? Because you can type. If you just go here and see, right, that if you type and put it away, nobody is going to see it. Keeps typewriter, not only, but demands particular, where is it? The least anyone else, if you give it to them, type a document, lock it away. Right? So it's because of complete privacy. Nobody can access a document that you have typed unless you give it to them. So they do not want to abandon old technologies that may be, again, future ka kuch baat nahi, no, future has been spoken about. They want to ensure that businesses know, not that lines should remain in business. They like the nostalgic appeal. That is what other people, why are we talking about governments? Not because of nostalgic appeal. This is people buying from eBay. Government is not buying from the eBay, right? They can control who reads a document. Yes, completely. Right? It is about locking it away, ensuring that those who have to see it, those are the only guys who see it. The writer praises typewriters for all of the following reasons. What are the reasons? Let's see some of them. They were that you have to be attentive, you don't have any distractions, right? There is a nice noise of those keys, etc. Okay, so now let's look at the options. Unlike computers, they can only be used for typing. This is a positive thing because you don't use the internet. It's mentioned that there are no online distractions. So A is a praise. A is good. Okay. So we cannot mark it. We are looking for an except. You cannot revise what you have typed on a typewriter. Yes. So you have to be attentive. So this is a praiseworthy thing also, that the typewriter wants you to be attentive. So B is also mentioned as praise. Typewriters are noisier than computers. This is also, you know, the nostalgic appeal of those keys, right? So this is also a praise. A, B, C, though they don't seem as if they're praising the typewriter, it actually is, right? But if you see D, messy, the only thing is they're talking about is a ribbon somewhere, but messiness and how the messiness is useful has not been mentioned. So the answer is option D. Very easy to read passage, very peaceful options. This was, I think, a passage that you should have attempted and got all three right. Here, next one now. Despite their fierce reputation, Vikings may not always have been the plunderers and pillagers popular culture imagines them to be. Okay, so popular culture sees them as plunderers, thieves, and pillages when you really destroy homes, people in them, right? In fact, they got their start trading in northern European markets, researchers suggest. Combs carved from animal antlers, as well as comb manufacturing waste and raw antler material, has turned up at three archaeological sites in Denmark including a medieval marketplace in the city of Reeb. A team of researchers from Denmark and the UK hoped to identify the species of animal to which the antlers once belonged by analyzing collagen properties in the samples and comparing them across the animal kingdom. Laura Gegell reports for Life Science. So this whole thing is a report from Laura Gegell. Somewhat surprisingly, molecular analysis of the artifacts revealed that some combs in other animals have been carved from reindeer antlers. Given that reindeer, this is the scientific name for reindeer, Rangifertarandus, whatever, so we don't pay attention to such facts, right? Don't live in Denmark, the researchers posit that it arrived on Viking ships from Norway. Antler craftsmanship in the form of decorative combs was part of Viking culture. Such combs served as symbols of good health. The fact that the animals shed their antlers also made them easy to collect from the large herds that inhabited Norway. Okay, so this whole paragraph is explaining why they think that there were some combs that were coming from Viking, that's a part of Viking culture that's coming from Norway, right? And hence there was some trading that was going on. Since the artifacts were found in marketplace at Idsel, it's more likely that the Norsemen came to trade rather than pillage. Most of the artifacts also date to the 780s, but some are as old as 725. That predates the beginning of Viking raids on Great Britain by about 70 years. So they're saying ki jo trading ho raha tha, this happened before they actually started the thieving and the raids on Great Britain. Traditionally, the so-called Viking Age began with these raids in 793 and ended with a Norman conquest of Great Britain in 1066. Okay, so they started on 793 and there's no dispute here. Okay, the raids did start in 793, the trading was before that. Archaeologists had suspected that the Vikings had experience with long maritime voyages that might have preceded their raiding days. Beyond Norway, these combs would have been a popular industry in Scandinavia as well. It's possible that the antler combs represented a larger trade network where the Norsemen supplied raw material to craftsmen in Denmark and elsewhere. Right? So this is all about how these Vikings were traders before they became plunderers, okay? And there is scientific evidence to back that up. Now, let's look at options. The primary purpose of the passage is, what is the purpose, guys? What is this all about? Okay, these guys used to trade before they became plunderers. To explain the presence, no. This is in fact a cause, it's not an effect. This is used to prove. So A is wrong. To contradict the widely accepted beginning date, no, there's no date ke bare mein, there is no contradiction or there's no agreement, right? So B is also wrong. To challenge the popular perception of Vikings as raiders by using evidence that suggests their early trade relations with Europe. So you are saying ke, okay, they were not raiders, but this is true, right? Based on the passage, we can say ki yes, before they became raiders, there were early trade relations with Europe. So C is looking very good. To argue that besides being violent pillagers, were also skilled craftsmen and efficient traders. Efficiencies ke bare mein nothing has been spoken. Whether they are making it, how well it was made, not been spoken. So answer is option C. Most of the artifacts also date to the 780s, but some are as old as 725. This is about saying ke pehle trade, then pillage. First, they were trading with Europe in 725 and then 793, they started actually raiding. So they are not changing the date of the raid or of the Viking age. So A is incorrect. They are not saying 725 mein raid started. So B is eliminated. Some could have come from Scandinavia. No, we are talking about Norway here. Okay. D is the best option. D is exactly what is stated, that the trade happened before the raids. All of the following hold true for Vikings except Vikings brought reindeer. So, you know, this is how cat options sometimes confuse us. They bought antlers ke combs. They didn't even bring the antlers. They bought combs made from antlers. So forget the reindeer. Uska antler ka bhi they have not mentioned. And here they are saying the actual reindeer, the animal they got. That is false. This is clearly false. So most probably A is the answer. Let's just check the others quickly. Before becoming the raiders of Northern Europe, Vikings had trade relations. Mentioned, B is true. Antler combs, regarded by the Vikings as a symbol of good health, were part of the Viking culture. Clearly mentioned, true. Vikings once upon a time had trade relations with Denmark and Scandinavia. Mentioned, true. So the answer is option A. Right? Great. Now we will start off with the three para summaries. Guys, I have told you all that para summaries karne ke liye, the only thing that you need to check with an option is that everything is right. Right? In the option that you have, you cannot have something from the passage mentioned in the wrong way. Okay? So what are the tips? The first thing is that the option should be right compared to the paragraph. Second is ki there should be no outside information. Outside information nahi hona chahiye. Third is, if both of these things are right for two options, then you go for the main thrust of the argument. What is the main point? So it's always important to have a good idea of the main point when you're reading this, after you finish reading, before you start looking at options. So North American walnut sphinx, blah, blah, blah. Imagine the name of this poor fellow, Juglandis, right? Is a 6-word name. We should not make fun of some people then, right? Look like easy meals for birds, but they have a trick up their sleeves. They produce whistles that sound like bird alarm clocks, scaring potential predators away. Okay, so there is a trick that these birds have, caterpillars have, right, that send the birds away. At first, scientists suspected birds were, so the birds are the predators, guys, we should get it right. Okay, the victim here is the caterpillar, who is this worm on the ground, and there are birds that are coming to kill it, okay. At first, scientists suspected birds were simply startled by the loud noise, but a new study suggests a more sophisticated mechanism. The caterpillar's whistle appears to mimic a bird alarm call, sending avian predators scrambling for cover. So birds think it's an alarm call. Avian means, you know, bird wale predators, and they then run and try and cover themselves. When picked by a bird, the caterpillars whistle by compressing their bodies like an accordion and forcing air out through specialized holes in their sides. The whistles are impressively loud. They have been measured at over 80 dB from 5 cm away from the caterpillar, considering they are made by a 2-inch long insect. So 2-inch hai, chota insect hai, short, right, small insect, and still that's a very loud noise. Okay, so the main point is that these caterpillars make a bird alarm call to scare the birds off. Okay, so let's look at options. North American walnut will whistle periodically. They don't whistle periodically. They whistle when they are pecked by a bird. So this is wrong. So A is out. Can whistle very loudly is shocking, as they are very small insects. Perhaps we'll keep it. But remember, guys, that isme birds nahi hai. Why they whistle is not mentioned, but as of right now, there's nothing wrong, so we'll keep it. In a case of acoustic deception, produce whistles that mimic bird alarm calls. This is perfect as of right now, much better than C, because it says why these guys whistle. So B is out and C is in. Right? See, so deception and trick up their sleeves. Ye hai, otherwise you'll say kare deception, where is it mentioned? Right? So this is the deception. North American, in a case of deception and camouflage. What is camouflage? Camouflage is when you try and look like the environment, and that is not being mentioned. It's outside information, right? So answer is option C. Great, let's look at the next para summary. Both Socrates and Bacon were very good at asking useful questions. In fact, Socrates is largely credited with coming up with a way of asking questions, the Socratic method, which itself is at the core of the scientific method popularized by Bacon. The Socratic method disproves arguments by finding exceptions to them and can therefore lead your opponent to a point where they admit something that contradicts their original position. In common, so this is Socrates, right? In common with Socrates, Bacon stressed it was as important to disprove a theory as it was to prove one. And real-world observation and experimentation were key to achieving both aims. Bacon also saw science as a collaborative affair, with scientists working together, challenging each other. So now let me tell you my thoughts about this. I mean, what the IAMS thing is, the right answer is pretty clear. Okay. So when you have a sentence like this, it was as important to disprove a theory as it was to prove one. There are two possible interpretations. One interpretation is this, that you are talking about the same theory. Okay, you should try to prove the theory also and disprove the same theory. You should try looking at both sides of the argument. This is the interpretation that IIMs have gone with. But there's another interpretation, right? The other interpretation is that you can prove, instead of proving any theory, right? It is sometimes as good to disprove any theory, which means you're not talking about the same theory. Right? In life, it may sometimes be better to disprove things than to prove things. And they are not in connection with each other. That's another interpretation. In that sense, this is a slightly challenging paragraph. Right? And I should have actually tried and avoided having this sort of dichotomy. But anyway, it's still a very interesting paragraph. And there are hardly any confusing options. So they both advocated clever questioning. See, they are both advocating questioning. Okay. And the main thing is that they're doing it by observing, leading people to contradictions so that they can admit that there's something wrong in their original position. But opponents to disprove this sounds like some mean men, right? That they're just trying to do this to disprove the arguments. No, they're just doing it in a very scientific way also. They're not really concerned with opponents as such. And that is why A is incorrect. Advocated challenging arguments and theories by observation and experimentation. This looks good. Right? You are advocating challenging arguments. This is very clearly mentioned and it is in common. By finding exceptions, ye sentence ke baad turant in common. And this is again continued. Right? Real world observation and experimentation. So, ye exceptions dono. Both scientists talk about it. So B is looking good. Both Socrates and Bacon advocated confirming arguments and theories. No. So they're saying it's better to disprove than to prove. So challenging is better than confirming. So C is out. Right? Both Socrates and Bacon advocated examining arguments and theories from both sides to prove them. Now, this is also good if we go with the original interpretation of the IIMs. That ek theory ko prove bhi karo, disprove bhi karo. So, you're looking from both sides to prove them. But for me, the more clear sense here is that, you know, you have to find exceptions. Both of them agree on that clearly. Only Bacon here is saying that it's as important as to prove as to disprove. So the IIMs say the right answer is D. Oh, where's the pen? Yeah, that the right answer is D. But I think B and D are quite confusing. And there would be a decent amount of students who would have marked B, saying that both sides is not clearly mentioned. So this is a slightly controversial question. And these questions do English, you know, it's all about somebody else writes something and then there is interpretation A and interpretation B and you don't know, unless the author comes and tells me that this is what he or she meant, right? Then it's difficult for two people to argue about the meaning. So anyway, the IIM answer here is option D. Yeah, great. Let's look at the next question. A fundamental property of language is that it is slippery and messy and more liquid than solid. A gelatinous mass that changes shape to fit. As Wittgenstein would remind us, usage has no sharp boundary. Oftentimes, the only way to determine the meaning of a word is to examine how it is used. So language is slippery, it is more liquid, right? There is no clear boundary on how we can use words. And in this current scenario, right, it's getting more and more without boundaries because now you have a online language, right? So the only way to determine is how it is used. This insight is often described as the meaning is used doctrine, that the meaning comes from use. There are differences between the meaning is used doctrine and a dictionary first theory of meaning. The dictionary's careful fixing of words to definition. So there are two ways of looking at language. Ek to meaning is used and the other is ke fixed meaning dictionary wala. Like butterflies pinned on the glass can suggest that this is how language works. The definitions can seem to ensure and fix the meaning of words, just as the gold standard can back a country's currency. What Wittgenstein found in the circulation of ordinary language, however, was a free-floating currency of meaning. So, unlike the dictionary, which is fixed, meaning is free-floating. The value of each word arises out of the exchange. The lexicographer abstracts a meaning from that exchange, which is then set within the conventions of the dictionary definition. Okay, so from the exchange, you set out a meaning and then you try and put it in the dictionary. Dictionary definitions are like gold standards. Artificial to nahi bola hai. And dogmatic bhi nahi hai. Dogmatic is something close to dogmas, right? So yeah, a little theoretical, but these two words not mentioned. So it is outside, out of scope, phase out. Language is already slippery. Given this, accounting for meaning in use will only exasperate the problem. There is no problem. The whole thing is only trying to explain how language works. There is no problem. So B is also wrong. Meaning is dynamic. Great. Definitions are static. Agreed, right? That's what they're saying. Gold standard, etc. The meaning in use theory helps us understand our cult from their meaning in exchange. And use and not vice versa. So this is what they are saying. This is your last two lines. Okay, the value of each word comes from how it is used. And the lexicographer then removes the meaning and puts it in a dictionary. So the definition of words are coming from meaning. That is clearly mentioned. C is looking very good. D, the meaning of words in dictionary is clear, fixed and less dangerous. Danger. So D is out. Just one word is enough to make something wrong. So answer is option C. Right? Great. Let's look at parajumbles. All parajumbles as usual are type in the answer. The implications of retelling of Indian stories. Hence, the stories we tell reflect the world around us. Okay. Yahan pe world hai. We cannot help but retell the stories that we value. After all, they're never quite right for us. And even if we manage to get them right, so there's a clear 3 and 4, we can see the link is there and it is 3, 4. They are only right for us. Other people living around us will have a different reason for telling similar stories. So first of all, 2 is a good beginning, right? That we can see the stories we tell reflect the world around us. And this world is also there in 5. So 2 and 5 have to start. There's a link between 2 and 5, right? What is the link? The world. Reflect the world around us. As soon as we capture a story, the world we are trying to capture has changed. So 2-5 ka link hai, 3-4 ka link hai. Now the only thing we have to fix, and 2-5 has to start, right? Okay. Is where will one go? The implications of retelling Indian histories, hence, takes on a new meaning. This hence can only come after all this explanation. So the actual order will be 2, 5, 3, 4 and then 1. Right? Great. Let's look at the next question. Again, mostly peaceful thing to see. Before plants can take life from atmosphere, nitrogen must undergo transformations, similar to ones that food undergoes in our digestive machinery. In its aerial form, nitrogen is insoluble, unusable, and is in need of transformation. Lightning starts a series of chemical reactions that need to happen to nitrogen, ultimately helping it nourish our earth. Nitrogen, an essential food for plants, is an abundant resource. Okay, so one of the most dramatic examples in nature of ill wind that blows goodness is lightning. This has to begin, right? I cannot use this anywhere else after we talk about nitrogen lightning. This is the best beginning. So 5 has to begin. And the dramatic example, right? 5, you can't talk about plant life, atmosphere, nitrogen, and then talk about 5. 5 has to start, right? Is lightning. Now, how does lightning do it? Lightning does it by starting the series of chemical reactions. So it has to be 5-3. The lightning connects it, right? Then I need to talk about what nitrogen is, why is lightning needed, because it is insoluble and is in need of transformation ke baad 2-1 ka bhi link hai. So it has to be 5-3-4-2-1. So once you get the beginning and you get the lightning connection, then you will get all the nitrogen together and you have to first describe what nitrogen is, what is the problem and why it needs transformation, right? So it's 5, 3, 4, 2, 1. Let's look at the next question. Placebo effects. This has huge implications for the healthcare system. What is this here? Right, as it operates today, where depleted resources and time lead to patients rotating in and out of doctors' offices, oftentimes receiving minimal care or concern, what is commonly referred to as bedside manner from doctors. The placebo effect is when an individual's medical condition or pain shows signs of improvement based on a fake intervention that has been presented to them as a real one and used to be regularly dismissed by researchers as a psychological effect. The placebo effect is not solely based on believing in treatment, however, as the clinical setting in which treatments are administered is also paramount. That the mind has the power to trigger biochemical changes because the individual believes that a given drug or intervention will be effective could empower chronic patients with the notions of our body's capacity for self-healing. So, okay, there are two contenders for the beginning beginning sentence. Two can begin and five can begin, right? This describes what placebo is and this talks about the study. Which should come first? See, one of them will come first, one of them will come second. So it's, you know, we can say placebo effects are now studied as a potential portal into the self-healing, and then we can describe placebo effect, right? But if you see, there is a nice critical now here. So two has to come before five. When you are saying that it was regularly dismissed by researchers, and then the five will continue beautifully. Placebo effects are now studied not just as foils for real interventions. Right? So you're saying that not just because people have the psychological fake intervention, real. So what is a fake intervention, guys? It's a foil for real intervention, right? So two and five ka definitely beginning, and that link is there. Right? Potential portal into the self-healing powers of the body. Okay. Now, that the mind has the power to, because the individual believes that a given drug will be effective, is the self-healing. The placebo effect is not solely based on believing in treatment, however, as the clinical setting in which treatments are administered is also paramount. So, out of 3 and 4, there is some confusion what should come first, but this has huge implications. This is the best conclusion to both 3 and 4. Right? So, one has to end. Potential portal into the self-healing ke baad has the power to trigger biochemical changes. And it is not solely based on believing in treatment. So, this is also paramount. So, four explains the self-healing powers. Mm-hmm. And that is why you should have four after five. And then you will have three. So the placement of three slightly, because again, you're talking about not solely based on believing in treatment, right? But you can see how three and one will connect very beautifully, right? That this has huge implications for the healthcare system. Okay, so the answer here is going to be 2, 5, 4, 3, 1. The last para-jumble theta. So another interesting, a good choice for para-jumble here. Let us see what we can learn here, okay? I'll just read each sentence and then we'll see what is the unusual thing. Johnson treated English very practically as a living language with many different shades of meaning and adopted his definitions on the principle of English common language according to precedent. Masking a profound inner torment, Johnson found solace in compiling the words of a language that was, in its coarse complexity and comprehensive genius, the precise analog. Analog here is something that is, you know, equivalent of his character. So his character was also had coarse complexity and comprehensive genius. Samuel Johnson was a pioneer. So definitely three has to come before two and one, right? Who raised common sense to heights of genius and a man of robust popular instincts whose watchwords were clarity, precision, and simplicity. We all need these watchwords. The 18th century English reader in the new world of global trade and global warfare needed a dictionary with authoritative acts of definition of words of a language that was becoming ceded throughout the first British Empire by a vigorous and practical champion. Now, this is the only sentence that does not have Johnson in it. Almost. Okay, so there is a nice hint. We'll talk about it later. Let's just finish the fifth sentence. The Johnson who challenged Bishop Berkeley's solipsist theory of the non-existence of matter by kicking a large stone, I refuted thus, is the same Johnson for whom language must have a daily practical use. So everything, right, has to have practical implementation. Now the thing is, guys, that we say ki four mein Johnson nahi hai, par hai, right, by a vigorous and practical champion. And there is a, there is not a the. So, you know, first of all, four has to come in the beginning or in the end. Otherwise, beech mein wo ajeeb lagega, right? It does not really continue Johnson at all. So, it has to come in the beginning or in the end. And because there is an a and not a the, it has to come in the beginning. Because if you spoke about Johnson throughout, then four will say empire by the vigorous and practical champion. Because it's obviously understood you're talking about somebody who have already spoken about, right? Because it is a, it should precede everything else and you should have four. After which, obviously, you'll introduce Mr. Johnson. So it has to be 4-3. And then, of course, you'll, you know, continue the Johnson introduction by talking about his practical use part, right? So it's 4-3-5. And between 1 and 2, you are saying that the profound inner torment is some sort of, again, conclusion. You can't have practical use, then torment, and then again practical, right? So it has to be practical use, practically, and then torment. So it has to be 5-1-2. A beautiful para-jumble example. 4-3-5-1-2. I must stop calling all these questions beautiful, right? I'm sure some students would be precisely hating me because of this. Oh, good Lord. Okay. 32. So now we are no more on para-jumbles. We are looking for odd sentences out, right? When we say odd sentence out, right, it is there. It is that question is there because the purpose of the question is that you find the odd sentence out. The purpose is not that you find the paragraph of the remaining four sentences. So don't try and do that unless you are getting lost in finding the odd man out. If you can find the odd man out straight away, just do that, move on. Don't get into making the order, right? So anyways, we'll try and do that once in a while because we also want to keep learning. But remember that all the time it will not be clear about what the order is. So although we are born with the gift of language, research shows us that we are surprisingly unskilled when it comes to communicating with others. We must carefully orchestrate our speech if we want to achieve our goals and bring our dreams to fruition. We often choose our words without thought, oblivious of the emotional effects they can have on others. We talk more than we need to, ignoring the effect we are having on those listening to us. We listen poorly without realizing it, and we often fail to pay attention to the subtle meanings conveyed by facial expressions, body gestures, and the tone and the cadence of our voice. So the first sentence has to be, it's an introduction of everything else, that we are poor at communicating. We are poor at communicating, right? And all of these almost are examples, right? We are oblivious of the emotional effects. We are ignoring the effect we have on others, and we don't listen properly. So 1, 3, 4, 5 are together. 2 is just a random statement. It is not telling me why I'm poor at communicating when all other options are clearly telling me that. All other sentences. So 2 is the one here that is odd, right? And if I had to give meaning, it would be 1 and 5 first. If I had to give it not meaning, sorry, the exact order. 1 has to begin because that introduces, right? And we're talking about 2 of them talk about how we use words, how we talk. So one of them talks about listening. So 1, 5, and then 4, and then 3, and then 2 is the one who's odd. And just finding the odd is enough, right? Next. Ah, Federer. So Federer has come a lot in CAT questions. There has been a passage on him. there have been a paragraph summary on Federer something long back, right? So definitely one of the paper setters is a Federer fan. Whenever you find anything on the internet about Federer, read it up. Aa sakta hai aapke paper mein, theek hai? Over the past fortnight, one of its finest champions managed to pull off a similar impression. Okay. Wimbledon's greatest illusion is the sense of timelessness it evokes. So there, similar impression, similar timelessness. One and two go together. It has to be 2-1 and none of them can be odd one out. At 35 years and 342 days, Roger Federer became the oldest man to win the singles title in the Open era a full 14 years after he first claimed the title as a scruffy, ponytailed upstart. This explains how the champion pulled off a similar impression. So three also has to be there. Once he survived the opening week, the second week witnessed the range of a rested Federer. If you're surviving the opening week, you're not even rested. You just managed to survive, that means you have worked hard. Okay. Given that his method isn't relying on explosive athleticism or muscular ball striking, both vulnerable to decay, there is cause to believe that Federer will continue to enchant for a while longer. And all of these passages and the para summaries that come in, guys, are always positive about Federer. So yeah, we have a fan in the paper setters. So five is general, four is too specific and also wrong. Four is the one that's odd man out, and this order here will be 2-1-3-5. Okay. Great. Last question, guys. Those geometric symbols and aerodynamic swooshes are more than just skin deep. The Commonwealth Bank logo, a yellow diamond with a black chunk sliced out in one corner, is so recognizable that the bank doesn't even use its full name in its advertising. It's not just logos with hidden shapes. Sometimes brands will have meanings or stories within them that are deliberately vague or lost in time, urging you to dwell deeper to solve the riddle. Graphic designers embed cryptic references because it adds a story to the brand. They want people to spend more time with the brand and have that idea that they are an insider if they can understand the hidden message. But the Combank logo has more to it than meets the eye. So 2-5 ka to clear hai link. As squirreled away in the diamond is a Southern Cross constellation. Take a 2-5 logos, cryptic references, they both again go together. What I'd like to understand is those symbols are a concise sentence. I've told you all, right? When you have these pronouns, reference, they have to refer to something else very clearly in the earlier sentence. And I don't find a single sentence that one can continue. So one is the odd one out here. Fairly easy, right? So great, guys. It was a very interesting verbal section. Great passages and great para summaries. So please just practice a lot of verbal. There is really no shortcut to verbal. I mean, I can't give you a tip book. I mean, I could give you a formula book for maths, right? But there is just no shortcut to practice. So the more you practice verbal, the better it is. And as I like to tell people, remind you all, pura paper English mein hai. The whole paper is in English. Your maths, your DI, everything will improve if your English comprehension goes up. Do not forget, right? Here is your puzzle. For tomorrow morning, you have to find the correct ordering of the area of these triangles, right? And here is your reading assignment. Go ahead, please read up. This is a very nice passage. And I'll see you all again tomorrow morning when we'll do the DILR for slot 2. And you can also find me on the Unacademy app. So guys, these are really a lot of positives, as I keep reminding you. And especially for CAT students. Right now, we have an awesome test series, 5 tests. Mein se 2 tests ho gaye hain. Please go and take those tests so that you know where you stand nationally. One of the best places to get your national ranks, right? Which subscription to go for? If you're focused on CAT 20, guys, you can look at the 12-month subscription because there will be exact, there will be other exams also that will follow up. And if you are confused between CAT 20 and 21, then you can look at the 24-month package, right? You can use the code MUNIRA10 to get a 10%.